I was flying with a crop circle researcher. We were flying to the southwest of the field here, and I went over a fixed route that I do many times, so I know all the fields in the area. And on the way out, there was no crop circle in this particular area. It was fairly close to the canal in the middle of the Vale of Pusey. We were no more than 10 minutes. We circled a few times, came back, and on the way back, there was a crop circle in the field. And I pointed it out to the crop circle researcher, and we both agreed that crop circle was not there on the way out, on the journey on the way out. So it must have appeared during daylight within 10 or 15 minutes maximum. And I couldn't see any people in the field, I could see no cars, there were no roads going to the field, just a small farm track. And I couldn't see how it could be made in 10 or 15 minutes.
The impressions that I have of the crop circles, that there is no way they could be made by humans. There is no way. They are so complex, they are so wonderful.
I think it brings people together from all over the world. And it's art in a wonderful way.
You know, it's so weird. It seems to happen only within minutes. And it's impossible to understand how it's done.
Every summer, hundreds of these strange patterns appear in fields all over the world. What on earth are they? Who has created them? Why do they do it, and what is their meaning? It happens in wheat, barley, oats, rye, rape. It happens in sand, and even in snow and ice during the winter. It happens where the landscape can be used as a huge canvas. Are some jokers out, just trying to create a little attention? It's easy to jump to that conclusion, but that's before you take a closer look at this phenomenon. When one studies the crop circles, close at hand and in detail, it's impossible to avoid that strange feeling that something else might be behind it all. It's impressive to see how the crop has been laid flat. Firstly, the edges have been clean cut, no trampling or bending. It's as though the crop has been combed with a huge comb. From the air, it looks as if a giant stamp has been used in the field. The phenomenon often starts in early summer, when the crop is green, and continues right up to harvesting. It normally happens during the night, but sometimes in the middle of the day. In a surprisingly way, the crop has been flattened with great precision. And no formation is alike, or seems to be half finished. The complexity varies, but even so, the beauty in the symbols and the overwhelming geometry is really astounding. The mystery and the wonder are just as great every time they are discovered. and the enormous size of many of these patterns makes the whole phenomenon even more incomprehensible.
If you look at the Milk Hill formation, now you only had 4 hours of night, I should say, and it was raining. Now, when I went in it first thing in the morning, there was no sign of any mud on the stalks. They were dead flat, and it was very, very meticulous, and there's no way you could put that pattern down in 4 hours of darkness. And you've got to remember, this area of Britain, you're not in total darkness, you're in semi-darkness. Now, I know for a fact that night there were people on the hill. And to make something that big, you would have had to have made a certain amount of noise, and nobody heard anything or saw anything.
Who are putting down these patterns? What is creating these formations? It still remains a mystery. The theories are many, which of course makes the whole phenomena even more interesting. And so far, the fields of southern England have been canvas for most of these crop formations.
Southern England, which appears to reassemble a huge crop field in itself, is divided up by small villages crisscrossed with twisting canals and roads. So this is where crop circles have been registered in great numbers. The first were already been observed several hundred years ago and were often seen as the work of the devil, as here, depicted in a copper engraving from 1678. Or one thought that elves had danced in the crop fields and left elf rings.
Over and over, there's nearly no decade where we don't have crop circle reports, and there are so many witnesses of early crop circles. Many farmers, if you talk to them, they remember having played in crop circles when they were kids, and remember stories from their parents and even their grandparents about the crop circles. And there is, around the world, we can find that the crop circles have played such an important part in the daily life, even centuries ago, that they have become part of the folklore and part of the culture.
As early as in the 1920s, crop circles were reported frequently in England. But it wasn't until the 1980s and 90s that interest grew. And that's when the dimensions and complexity became truly sensational. In recent years, some 100 to 300 crop circles have appeared here each summer. What is so special about this area? In the southwestern part of England, we find many imposing monuments that are several thousand years old and that still pose many questions to archaeologists and historians, especially the question why. Stonehenge, approximately 4,500 years old, is the most famous. The original outer continuous circle was constructed of huge standing stones, each weighing several tons, with lintels posed very precisely on top of them. What is this and why was it built? No one, in all certainty, can explain.
The majestic stone circle in Avebury is also one of the great mysteries of this area. It's actually the world's largest stone circle. And some of the stones here have the weight of over 100 tons. Set up by people, primitive people, 5,000 years ago. Silbury Hill, the largest prehistoric mound in Europe, 40 meters high and built 4,600 years ago. Beneath the grass now covering the hill are seven layers of stone, seven stone terraces. But what the purpose was for building it still remains a mystery.
But this is by no doubt built as a tomb. Not very pleasant, actually. And it's from the same period, 5,000 to 6,000 years ago. West Kennet Longbarrow is situated quite close to Silbury Hill and Avebury. But is it just a coincidence that so many of the English crop circles seem to appear close to these ancient sites?
A number of white horses, clearly visible in the hillsides, are also characteristic of the Wiltshire area. The white chalk soil is very common here in Wiltshire, and these white horses are exposed by removing the top turf. Some of these horses, the eldest ones, are more than 2,000 years old.
So, can the mysteries of the past have anything to do with today's crop circles? Are there special energies in these areas that could attract such rare phenomena? Is it something to do with the water-bearing chalk hills that create special energy?
We actually got the databases for a period of 7 years and plotted where every crop formation that was in the databases, and we searched several databases within England, we plotted where those crop circles occurred and then looked for correlations with sacred sites, pilgrim routes, and we found a strong correlation with chalk. And first of all, we thought this was the correlation, but then we thought, well, there's a lot of places with chalk where crop circles don't occur. What's happening there? And as we looked into chalk more, we discovered that actually the chalk is the main aquifer base for southern England. We found that 98% of all crop circles in southern England are located above aquifers, underground water. And to put it in perspective, there's only aquifers under 40% of the landmass of Britain. So the 98% was really convincing statistic. But what we also discovered was that it's not just underground water, it has to be potentized underground water. It's water which is activated by the currents of earth energy which course through the ground, and they're very strong in this Avebury area, for example.
Well, there is one view, particularly from people that dowse using rods and pendulums and things, that ancient man instinctively knew where these areas of underground water and where these natural energies were. So ancient man instinctively placed their areas there on the sites where we now have stone circles, burial mounds, whatever, because they were drawn to the same thing that maybe is generating the crop circles today. So therefore it would stand to reason that they would cluster in the same areas as these ancient sites.
But it's not only in England that crop circles appear. In recent years, reports have been coming in from all over the world. So crop circles are now a worldwide phenomenon.
In total, over 10,000 crop circles have been registered on a world basis in the United States, Canada, Australia, in the Far East, and of course in Germany, Holland, Belgium, Poland, Italy, Denmark, Sweden, Norway, and in many other European countries. But again, how does this come about? When one looks at the beautiful patterns and the perfect geometry, it's difficult to believe that it's purely a coincidence, a natural occurrence, or just wind that has wreaked havoc on the crop. If that was the case, it might rather have looked like this. Or is it just that people are behind all this? In 1991, two pensioners in England by the name of Doug Bower and Dave Corley announced that they were responsible for all the crop circles the past 12 years, with the help of planks, ropes and tape measures. But they were quickly shown to be bluffing. It became clear when they were invited to create a crop pattern. Rightly so, there is no doubt that people have been responsible for making some of them. And even some of the more advanced ones too. An advertising company made this one. It took several days and was completed in daylight.
Doesn't seem to be any random uniform mechanism to the actual things going down at all. Interestingly, I've seen hoaxes go down and it's taken like 8 or 9 hours to make a fairly basic pattern, you know, and then I've seen highly sophisticated, huge patterns, you know, 1,000 feet wide, and they've appeared in, you know, a few hours of darkness, 3 or 4 hours sometimes, you know. I mean, the British summertime is actually very short nights, you know, we're looking at, gets dark around about, fully dark around about 11 p.m. and it's light again by around about 4 a.m. You know, this is a pretty small window, and some of these circles, you know, the size, the scope and the complexity, taking into account the topographical considerations, it does beg the question, how on earth could that be done?
Also, the fact that over 80 eyewitnesses have, over the past 20 years, seen crop circles created in just seconds, leaves little doubt that a large number of crop circles remain an unsolved mystery.
I, for instance, discovered a crop circle, literally a circle, I think the largest or the second largest circle ever made. It was in a formation that was called the Snail in, I think it was 92. And I happened to be going off to the dentist quite early in the morning and saw a shadow in the field, in Eastfield. And I thought, I'll blow it. And I walked, and it had rained all night, and we were on clay soil. So by the time I got there, my feet were weighing, you know, pounds. I was covered in clay. And I can honestly say that circle was pristine. There wasn't any dirt on it anywhere. And I just know that if people had trampled on it, even in bare feet, they would have left a lot of mud and a lot of marks. So I personally don't believe that they're all man-made by a long way.
I have the feeling that it has to be done probably from some external force, and we just don't know the technology that they're using. It's something that we don't know exists, I think. I used to think that it was man-made, and okay, there are man-made circles about, but I think when you analyse them closely, this has got to be done by some external force, and say, I should think it's some technology that we just don't know, we haven't come across it yet, we're still learning.
There are many theories as to what might be behind the crop circle phenomenon, from extraterrestrials to earth energies, earth spirits, or perhaps even a natural weather phenomenon. Nobody's really sure. And I guess that's really the big question in the crop circles. It's something that everybody talks about all the time.
A paranormal phenomenon for everyone to see. And every summer, people are gathering from all over the world to study this. And if not for any other reason, the crop circles obviously have the ability to make people interact.
Also, I just find that the sheer aesthetic of the way the blades are all laid down in a swirl, in this kind of rhythmic movement, is just something that I can't conceive of anything but some amazingly powerful higher force could do, you know.
And when something this magnificent is such a wonderful gift to us, we have to feel good about ourselves. Wow, we've been given this gift, and we can enjoy it and be grateful for it.
You've got to remember, everybody that walks into that field, the first thing they're going to do is be aware of how they feel. That's what these patterns do. They get you back in touch with that energy that is you, that feeling that's inside. I mean, heck, how long has it been since a lot of these people even contacted that side of themselves? And by going into these patterns, it makes you aware of yourself again. It gets you in touch with that feeling side, because humanity has become a little bit insensitive in a lot of ways. And the patterns are starting to help people to rediscover and redefine that sensitivity so that humanity can work as one again, instead of little individual islands.
So how can one actually prove that there is something paranormal, supernatural or extraterrestrial being behind all this? And if there is, what it is?
Many crop circle researchers have been engaged in trying to find differences in the crop and soil inside compared to outside the formations. If this, for example, has been exposed to a heavy electromagnetic force, one should be able to find traces of it.
Most importantly, visual traces can be found on the crop within many circles. Very often you can see where one or several nodes of the actual crop stem has been expanded, so as to be double and sometimes even more as its natural length. This can indicate that the crop has been rapidly heated up and that the humidity inside the stem has been subjected to steam pressure, which in turn has led to the node being stretched. On some of the stem nodes, you can also clearly see where the steam has forced its way out and left expulsion cavities. This can be an indication that the crop has been subjected to a rapid and powerful microwave effect.
If you see either of those effects, the chances are very good you're looking at a genuine crop circle. There are a number of changes in the plants that have not been documented scientifically, which may also indicate the likelihood that it's genuine. For instance, the lay, the detail of the lay of the crop. But that has not been evaluated scientifically. It's more just what people notice, you know, from being in them so much.
Sometimes I've seen areas where the plants are bent over, say 10, 15 centimeters off the ground. So that to walk through the formation, it's crunching under your feet like snow. So you think, well, somebody hasn't been here before.
Another sign one can find, especially in wheat, is when the corn has dried and turned golden in late summer. In the standing crop, the ears are stiffened in a bent position due to their weight and are impossible to straighten out. But within the crop circle, the ears have actually been straightened out and then stiffened again in this position. The research group BLT Research, which is running scientific publicized research on crop circles, is also engaged in a systematic trial of the soil and have often found strange metal particles in the upper layers of the soil within the crop circles. A specialist from America is analyzing these tests.
And he pulverizes the dirt and then runs it through various grates and with very strong magnets draws out the magnetic particles, weighs them. Well, weighs the whole soil sample first, then weighs the amount of particles. So we know how many particles per gram of soil. Then, once we've done that, extracted them, we send them off to the West Coast to a mineralogist who does SEMEDS. And the idea then is to determine what they're made of. The soil work indicates the presence of a magnetic iron, tiny little spherules of magnetic iron. And it's not only their presence which is of interest, it's the manner in which they're distributed. Frequently around the periphery of these circles, sometimes distributed linearly, indicating a delivery system that's fairly sophisticated.
This research group has also found interesting effects tied to the growth of the crop within the circles.
Some of the results clearly show that when those energies, when this crop circle making system impacts the plants, if they're not mature, if the seed is not formed, what happens is that those seeds are dehydrated, they don't mature properly, and they don't produce new plants. If that were to happen all over the world, simultaneously we'd lose our food stock. Obviously that's important. In addition, the germination work shows that when these energies impact the plants, later on when the seed is fully developed, then you get this very energized effect. Levengood and Burke were able to demonstrate that that was due to these very precise electrical pulses. And out of that grew their discovery of how to replicate that effect.
The crop circles have consequently shown the way for a new method of increasing the growth rate in crop, independent of environmentally dangerous chemicals. Just by giving the crop seeds a short controlled dose of electrical pulses before sowing, the method is being tried out now in the USA and is, to say at least, extremely interesting. So that an electromagnetic field of some sort or another is part of the crop circle phenomenon seems to be quite possible. Remains of the electromagnetic field can quite often be registered by using different types of equipment on site.
On a few occasions, on what we consider to be genuine formation, the meter has started off normal at background level, cosmic radiation from the heavens, and all of a sudden it's shot up to 10, 15 times.
Strangely enough, Dave. We went in there, David was stood there with the meter, it's just normal background, about 0.5, was it, something like that. And then all of a sudden, it shot up and went
10
up.
Or 12.
It's about 10 or 12, which is maybe 20 times normal background radiation. So we then thought we would walk outside the formation and see if the reading would alter. And we got about 15 paces or so, perhaps, and the meter dropped right back to 0.5, which was normal background.
People with all sorts of instrumentation come into fields and find battery drains, cameras sometimes don't work, phones go off, video cameras stop running.
Every year I bring my camera here, and every year I get it fixed, and Canon are getting fed up, and it's working outside the crop circle. I bring it into the crop circle, tape's jammed, total, it's a write-off. This is trying to tell me something about some kind of event definitely going on here. Whatever is happening, or whatever's making these things, man or beast or whatever, something is affecting, there's a signal, something's trying to tell us something, that there's hello knocking on the door, knocking on the head. Something's going on here. Needs investigation. We need to pay careful attention to what's going on here, and be careful.
Several other methods are also used to examine the effects of this phenomenon.
It suddenly dawned on me that maybe if I buried water, little bottles of water, as soon as possible after a formation had appeared, if I buried them about 2 inches deep, they were only 25 mil bottles of water.
Research by burying small bottles of water for a period of 10 days gave very interesting results. Frequency analyzer showed that the water samples had altered their frequency pattern differently from the control samples outside the circles. Furthermore, the bacteria content was much higher within the formation. A third analyzer's method showed that the water had increased its ability in so-called molecular memory.
So here we are with three different techniques, all showing that something anomalous was happening to the water buried inside. I'm perfectly certain this phenomenon is a beneficial one. It's not malevolent, but the energies that we're dealing with a set of very complex, subtle energies which interact in a personal way with our own metabolisms. People have these wonderful events, and they come back and they're sort of radiant people. And this is lovely. But I have to say, and I do have to emphasize this quite strongly, that not everybody feels well. If they feel ill, come out very quickly. If anybody is pregnant or thinking of becoming pregnant, I'd say don't go in, because we don't know really what we're dealing with. And most emphatically, if anybody's got a health device which is geared by a battery, for goodness sake, don't go in. We've had too many electrical failures, dramatic electrical failures. Sometimes I've been flying over formation and the instruments in the plane have gone all haywire. And my camera refuses to work just when I've got the most perfect shot. It won't work. Oh! But again, another thing we're doing is measuring the protein content of seeds taken from inside as opposed to outside. And what we found last year was that we're getting a 50% increase in the protein level from inside.
Maybe this can be connected to the increased growth rate that was shown in the crop seeds. But it also seems that human hormones can be influenced within the crop circles too.
Well, certain people, the thyroid was most affected of all. One woman had a 40% decrease in her thyroid level. And yet, here we were in a time scale of between 2 and 2.5 hours, and a 40% drop. So what the hell was going on? And this again shows us that in terms scientific research, we are finding things existing inside the formations which don't exist outside.
I have to say that phenomenon that occurred just now, when I couldn't turn my
digital camera on, standing inside the circle, was impressive. I believe in energy forces. I believe that there may be very high energy here, which could interfere with electrical equipment.
It just seems like it's some sort of energy, that's some sort of frequency that's different, but that it's a frequency that's affecting our skin and maybe even the blood flow, because we were having these little white things show in the skin that don't usually show there. So there's something, we don't know what it is, but it's something different that's radiating here from these plants.
Yeah.
A new crop circle has been discovered, and the excitement, as usual, is high. Is it genuine, and what are the patterns like? What about the geometry? And not at least, what sort of traces will we find here?
In some crop formations, you go in, and over the entirety of the whole formation, if you bend down and you examine the crop in detail, you'll find it's bent at the base, and then all along the rest of the stem, there's no damage. It's just pristine. There's no marks or creases. Now, we've got to be very, very careful because it's been here all day and we're not the first people that have walked into it. So people walking around are going to have added damage. So what we might see as damage, we might think is from the first cause, but in actual fact, it's been done by visitors. I must say, this is less damage than I've seen in some formations, but it is there.
Visible breaks on some of the crop stems can indicate that something physical has been used to flatten the crop. Or are these traces of other visitors who have been here before us? We can't find any immediate signs of stretched nodes or expulsion cavities either. So again, what or who is behind this one must remain another mystery.
72!
I think it's something like that. This is laid crop, and then it has a ring around the outside as well.
However, measuring the pattern shows that it's approximately 200 feet in diameter. It's a very clear geometric pattern, but only when it's seen from the air can we determine what it actually looks like. The geometry of the crop circles has remained an integral part of the studies for a long time. Some people have gone so far as to suggest that there is some sort of hidden code or message here. Others see the geometry just as an aesthetic expression. Mathematical fractals can only be made with the help of a computer, so how can they be created in a crop field? This appeared in the middle of the day and in under half an hour without anyone in sight. Pilots who crossed the area with tourists confirmed this. Where do all these original designs come from that no one lays claim to? Are they crossovers from another dimension? Do the symbols represent a kind of communication initiative? Is this part of our evolving knowledge of reality?
The crop circles are coming down as shape, as form, as design. And I believe these shapes are touching something very deep within us. And these shapes are the language that conversation has been opened in.
Okay.
Yeah. You know.
Yeah.
I think the intelligence behind the crop circles has decided with great wisdom that this conversation, which has a long program and a long agenda, is best established with form.
Symbols are about understanding what kind of world we live in, and it explains, it transmits the understanding of how the universe works and the kind of laws we're under. And this is actually a spiritual teaching. Mathematics will go into it and try to explain it from the point of view of matter, of it, the effect of that on the physical. The ancient knowledge is talking about principles and concepts behind the physical, you see. So to reach that level of understanding, you have to go above the physical. You have to rise your mind above the what you can see, touch, feel, taste, and so on. You have to raise above the physical. And in that sense, you're growing in understanding. The ancient expression, growing in understanding, that's exactly that. You grow in understanding. Whereas if you bring everything down to, oh, it's not laid properly, oh, it's not quite straight, you bring everything down and you don't look at the symbol, you just look at the physical aspect. You bring it down to your own level of what should be right and what should fit your idea, you know? But this is a chance now. We have to really begin to see the big picture.
It's striking that the basic geometrical forms such as circles, squares, triangles, pentagrams, etc. seem to create the basis for the construction in most of the patterns in crop circles. The principle of the golden section and ratio pi is often repeated in the constructions. Is it the geometry that is the key in understanding the phenomenon, or is it the phenomenon that is the key in understanding a deeper meaning in the geometry? There have been several sensational discoveries that in fact point in that direction.
I mean, there's a couple of solutions which are not only astonishingly accurate, they're astonishingly simple, that I'm just amazed that no one in the 2,000 odd years of people studying this problem haven't discovered before. I mean, breathtakingly simple.
The solutions that Alan Brown had found are tied to a known geometrical problem that mathematicians have struggled with for over 2,000 years. The act of squaring the circle with compass and ruler, which involves creating a square and a circle whose perimeters are equal. This, in fact, is impossible to achieve with 100% accuracy, due to the impossibility of constructing the irrational number pi, which again is used to calculate the circle's circumference. There are known methods on how to get quite close to a solution, but new principles for doing this with an accuracy only limited to the thickness of the pencil line was revealed in a crop circle. In 1997, Michael Glickman discovered that one of the circles that year contained some very special proportions.
What Michael Glickman noticed about that formation was that if you connected up the centers of the four satellite circles and drew a square, then that square would be in exactly the squared circle proportions as to this circle, which was represented by the mother circle. So this formation encoded a squared circle.
Alan now began to look at crop circles throughout the past 25 years that seemed to have the same common proportions. Simple formations with four satellite circles around a center, so-called quintuplets. He understood that these demonstrated the same principle of squaring the circle.
What I found that the fact that they so comprehensively did it right the way from like the first one I studied in 1983 right the way to the last one I studied in 2002 was that the same notion of the squaring of the circle was being demonstrated in all that body of formations over a 25-year span.
On closer studies of these circles, he suddenly discovered new simple and elegant construction methods regarding this problem that had never been seen before. Is it possible that something such as that can suddenly appear by chance in a field of flattened corn?
This is just taking the most simple, simple geometry that even a school kid can learn and recombining it in an incredibly simple way, which then allows solutions to just drop out of the hat, as it were. So, I mean, and again, I find that is, to me, an indicator of intelligence. It's not going deeper into complexity. It's taking the simplest component part and recombining them in a way which we've just never thought to do. So simple.
These new methods connected to squaring the circle uses three basic elements that symbolize the earth, human beings, and the wholeness. Is a spiritual message hidden here? Is this an encouragement to the human race to seek a new understanding in connection with our relationship to Earth and the wholeness? Strangely enough, this also relates to the difference in size between the Earth and Moon's radiance.
You can then run a circle through the center of the Moon, which then squares the circle.
And maybe even more remarkable is that the same principle is again noticed in Stonehenge, in relation to the distance between the inner and outer stone circles. Did man, some 5,000 years ago, know something that we don't or have forgotten? Or is this again just another coincidence? And when one takes the Earth's diameter and the Earth plus Moon's radius in English miles, so, correspondingly, it relates to the same figures in feet and decimals as to Stonehenge. These figures, 50-40 and 79-20, are keys to that basic and traditional formulation of number that lay on the root of all ancient culture. 50-40 is the first seven numbers multiplied together. 79-20 appears by multiplying the next four. The Greek philosopher Plato describes these numbers as the key symbols of the divinely ordered creation. And so another crop circle appears, where the amount of standing and flattened elements also show to be the same figures in a scale of 1 to 10. Its construction is of the most advanced geometry, consisting of 144 circles around a circle. Challenging enough to construct on paper, but in the middle of a crop field at night, and even without touching the center of the pattern. This remarkable formation, only lasting a few hours before the harvesters moved in, not only in total clarity symbolizes the DNA spiral, but also the squaring of the circle and the relationship between the Earth and Moon by divine numbers. And to add it all up, the sum of these two numbers is 1296, which again is 6 times 6 times 6 times 6. In the ancient Greek alphabet, these numbers correlate to letters spelling out a name. That name is Goddess of All Creation.
To me, even now, after having lived with this diagram for 2 years, my hair stands on end, I've got goosebumps, because, you know, you as a designer, if someone came to me and said, look, I want you to design a picture which has got 792 elements somehow and 504 elements, see if you can come up with something interesting. To come up with that, a perfect rotating DNA spiral, encoding those numbers, is in itself a work of genius. But then to find that in a wheat field in August, there, beautifully formed, and it seems to me the most sane way of dealing with this is to accept that this is a demonstration of a level of intelligence and compassion towards us, which is pulling us up. We have to look at the square in the face, and I think it's a truly extraordinary bit of intelligence and geometry.
Again, new seasons bring new crop circles with fresh original designs and new exciting geometry. A circle divided into 13 parts, or divided into 7, 11, and 13 parts. In addition to a row of new fantasy-filled patterns, many of these are pure logos that advertising agencies would demand a great deal of money to develop. Here we can pick and choose for free.
How it was made is not that important. I think, you know, these symbols are messages or means of communication to the human race from some other living creatures.
The theory of this not being man-made is backed up by the fact that more and more people have been seeing strange lights and glowing objects in connection with the crop circles.
Inhabitants in Wiltshire have, through ages, reported strange light phenomena. Maybe is it not so strange that one of the hills in the area was named Golden Ball Hill? During the last few years, these balls have also been filmed on several occasions. The balls of light seem to have some sort of connection with the crop circles. They have often been seen to be moving within the formations, directly over them or away from them. They appear to be of soccer ball size and have often been described as having an impressive acceleration. Are these some sort of intelligent energy balls or remote-controlled supernatural robots? Or maybe they are the mythical elves that we have heard about?
Those balls of light, you cannot hoax. There's no way you can do that. They fly around during daytime. They're not high up in the sky, but they're over fields with hills in the background. They are filmed on many occasions by many different people.
Have you seen any of these yourself?
I've once seen an amber ball of light at nighttime. That was pretty impressive. I saw it for several minutes, and it just floated over a field. And it looked like an open fireplace. It would get bigger and smaller. I had a good binoculars. I could see it was circular, but it was not like a flashlight or something. And it made a deep impression on me. It happened in 97, and my life has not been the same anymore since that time.
During the filming of these balls of light, a military helicopter showed up and clearly seemed to be chasing the phenomenon. It's not so unusual that the military in this area are on the spot when light phenomena are observed or crop circles appear, but the military, at present, refuse to make any comments about it.
They're so often seen, filmed, photographed, whatever, you know, over and around the crop circles. And they do this in broad daylight, you know, in the night, whenever. Officially, the crop circles are all one big joke. Let's all go back to sleep, there's nothing to see. And if that's the case, why are they deploying such high technology helicopters and personnel to, you know, look at this situation? It doesn't make sense. So clearly they know that we know that they know that something is going on.
And I know last year there was lots of helicopters flying very low after these orbs of light around here. So a lot of people getting complaints about it because the helicopters were following some invisible light forms doing something. They were definitely meaning business. So I think there's something involved here which is playing with our peripheral consciousness. And if something's playing with your peripheral consciousness and your peripheral perception, that could be a good thing or it could be a bad thing. I think people need to be on their guard when they have their wonder open up. When you're wondering about things, you might let something else in. I think we need to be careful about what's going on here. I think it's wonderful and it's great, but I think we need to be just on our guard with what's happening, with our consciousness here.
Several instances have been recorded whereby people have had close contact with these balls of light.
I arrived to spend the night in the circle about 10 o'clock p.m. in the night. My partner and a friend of ours is sitting on the hill behind us at Milk Hill. Around about midnight, it was very clear. The sky was absolutely very clear, quite crisp. And for out of the blue, out of nowhere, right in front of me, maybe 10 meters out in front of me, a ball of light about a soccer ball size appeared out of nothing, hovering just above the ground and behind a standing tuft of rapeseed stems at the center of the circle. So I was kind of observing this light through the stems, and it was kind of putting them into silhouette. It hovered exactly in the same position for at least 30 or 40 seconds, long enough for me to get up, move my position and look around the actual standing tuft, and just to actually see this ball of light. There's no doubt at all, it was certainly there, and it appeared from nowhere, and it stayed there for a maximum of about 1 minute, maybe 1.5 minutes. And after this amount of time, it faded and kind of just faded to nothing over the course of a few seconds. Extremely strange and very close, but I did not perceive any interaction. It was like an observer's experience only. I was left sitting there rather bemused with my camera right on my lap, which I didn't use for some reason. And I immediately fell asleep and woke up at 8 o'clock in the morning. Fairly good night's sleep. And my partner arrives in the formation and tells me that they have seen effectively the same thing which I saw, but they saw it from their vantage point, 200 meters behind me and elevated probably 100 feet. You know, they saw the same thing, what appeared to be the same thing. They come into the field, into the circle, and then they lost it, and as they lost it, I got it. And it tied together very well. You know, it seemed to, it provided, you know, for me, independent confirmation, because I did wake up thinking, well, was that a dream or something? But so it was pretty much confirmed, and it was extremely close enough to be absolutely certain that that was something extremely strange in there with me. And it wasn't anything that I've ever seen before that close.
From this height, Oliver's Castle, one of the most often debated observations, was made early one morning in 1996. A young man spending the night here with his video camera was in the early dawn suddenly aware of something strange unfolding down in the field.
Here I'm standing at Oliver's Castle, at precisely the same spot as John Whaley was standing in August 1996, when he supposedly, for the first time in history, managed to film the creation of a crop circle.
That the crop circle was not here the previous day but had appeared the following morning was a fact. That John Whaley was here at dawn could be confirmed by a military patrol jogging by at that time. John returned to the local pub later that same day and played this remarkable footage from his camera. Even so, many believe that he had managed to manipulate the film with computer animation during this short time span, something that computer animation experts doubt. To overlay a perfect animation over a handheld, unstable film would need several days of computer work using the equipment of that time. Today, the film is still a great mystery. Although confessions now have been made by people claiming to be responsible for it as a hoax, others believe the hoax theories to be organized debunking, due to the fact that this remarkable footage would have dangerous effect on the public if declared real. Anyway, the repeatedly seen and filmed balls of light are indeed difficult to explain as birds, flying plastic bags, computer animation, or whatever. So are they signs of life existing parallel to ours, but in another dimension? And are they responsible for all the genuine crop circles? Speculation continues to grow in size the more one studies the phenomenon.
I personally am convinced that the vast majority of crop formations are not made by people. They're made by some unexplained agency, whether it be extraterrestrial or interdimensional or from the Earth or whatever. Mm-hmm. With regard to the lights, there have been so many instances where the lights have been seen either before crop formations appear or over crop formations. That, again, I think there's a connection between the lights and the crop circles, certainly.
Again, I'm in a fresh and newly appeared crop circle, and I must admit the feeling is quite stunning. It's easy to see why people are attracted by this, but what I don't understand is why the media don't seem to be attracted at all.
They don't like questions which can't easily be answered. So the media have only really liked this when we get to the question of hoaxing and of people making it, Doug and Dave and all that,
yeah.
Which is a nice, neat thing. You know, it wraps it up in a parcel. We can put it away. That's solved and finished. Now let's get back to the football, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
And so really the media don't want to do this one. Even people like the BBC don't want to do this one because it's a big question and it concerns the future of civilization.
We believe that the formations are tangible evidence, aren't they? That that we're not alone, and our government and other governments has for years been trying to tell us that we are alone, and ridiculing all the people who've seen craft and had experiences. And I think they're frightened to death of the fact that here we have fantastic evidence, and they're doing their best to tell us that they're all hoaxes. Even the newspapers in this country seem to be in on it. You know, they it amazes me that reporters, journalists have under their noses, you know, one of the most fantastic stories ever, and yet they completely dismiss it out of hand. It's as if they're frightened to get involved with it somehow.
Would you like to be the news editor who published a headline, "Everything we believe in is now destroyed"? I don't think so. So the newspapers, the media, are very good at... and the little joke at the end. Oh, little green men from Mars. Yeah.
But in 2001, suddenly the media paid some interest, because then something appeared that was almost impossible to overlook. Right behind me is Britain's largest radio telescope, the Chilbolton Observatory. And here it was that the greatest sensation in the crop circle history was to appear in the fields right in front of the telescope.
On the morning of 14th of August 2001, a formation was discovered which was different from any other previously seen. From the ground, it looked like a tangled mess, wisps of crop spread around in no system. However, in the evening, with growing shadows, a picture appeared, unmistakably that of a face. That picture represented a whole new technique, a screen technique, the same that's used for printing a picture on paper. 3 days later, the face was joined by something that looked like a data strip. Rows of counters made out of standing and flattened crop. But soon, an astonishing similarity is discovered. In 1974, the astronomer Carl Sagan composed a message that NASA sent into space from the Arecibo telescope in Puerto Rico. Binary figures, which constituted a graphic code presenting key factors about humans and the planet we live on. 27 years later, an identical pattern appears in a crop field right in front of a similar radio telescope. However, on closer inspection, it seemed to show that the code contained some fundamental differences. Sagan's message explained our calculation system, the dominant chemical substances within the elements that create life on Earth, about our DNA code, humans' height and quantity, and that we live on the third planet in our solar system. And lastly, a sketch of our radio telescope. The message received described the same calculation system, but that silicon is most dominant in life forms in contrast to carbon. The drawing also clearly shows a humanoid figure with large head in relation to its body. It's also explained that they have an extra string in their DNA, are approximately 4 feet tall, inhabit the third, fourth, and fifth planets in their solar system, and have a population of around 21.3 billion. Underneath, the telescope has been replaced by something more complex. 1 year earlier, a strange crop circle had appeared in the same place. Is this the same illustration as in the sender's code? Is this the correspondence radio telescope? If this is not an extremely clever and well-calculated joke conducted by humans, is it a serious response from an alien civilization?
The Teal-Balton crop formations really gave new life to the speculations of who is behind this. Is it aliens? Where do they come from? And what is their purpose of this type of communication?
The following year, very nearly on the same day, a new picture appears that gives new force to the alien theory, this time in Crabwood, near the town of Winchester in Hampshire. Once again, we see a face, but this time there is an unmistakable resemblance to something extraterrestrial. The picture also contains a print, somewhat similar to that of a CD, with something that appears to be a coded message. This formation also has a new type of design, this time with horizontal line patterns of variable thickness, similar to that of a TV picture. The message on the disc is similar to a spiral band built up of many boxes. But data expert Paul Vige manages to decipher the message.
And I had to enlarge the disc quite substantially on the computer and run some image analysis over it to make it clear so that I could see what was a standing tuft and what was flattened. And while I was doing this, I noticed that every so often there was almost a mistake in the diagram. It was like there was a tuft, where the little square of tuft, it had done sort of half size. And I thought, that's a bit odd, and it seemed fairly regular. I was going round, and I sort of counted up, and it was sort of literally every sort of 8 bytes or whatever. And I thought, oh, 8 bytes, and yeah, from computer side, is obviously some sort of binary code. So then I did the straightforward thing. I just converted it into ASCII. Which is the standard sort of computer language that you encode the alphabet in. And of course I then started to get words forming out, and I thought, getting somewhere here. So I then did the whole thing for the whole lot, and got this message.
The message is in English and reads as follows. Beware the bearers of false gifts and their broken promises. Much pain, but still time. There is good out there. We oppose deception. Conduit closing. Many have been surprised by this message. Are there aliens with such faces that we should be aware of? Or is this a picture of the sender? Does this indicate the start of actual close contact with neighbors in the universe?
My own, and this is only a hypothesis, belief about this is that there's an effort of the extraterrestrials are gradually trying to communicate with us, a very slow process, giving us a lot of time to digest the fact that we may not be alone here.
I've been researching the UFO phenomenon for longer than the circles, and I think there is a connection between the two. And whatever agency is involved is obviously, I think we're, although it's a bit of a cliche now, but it's kind of building up to some kind of contact within a short space of time. I think that these signs, or there are signs, or some of them warning signs, if you look over the history of the phenomenon. And they work on different levels. They work on a subliminal level, a level of consciousness, influencing people's consciousness. So I think in a way they're kind of preparing us for some kind of contact, maybe a more open contact within the next few years, possibly.
I think this is the biggest gift we have ever had on the planet. I think it's the most important moment we've ever had on the planet. I think it brings us nothing but good. I think we should all sit calmly and accept the future, because we're in the middle of a dimensional shift right now. And I think our cousins out there, our sisters, realize that planet Earth is famously like this in the universe, and we are going to be dragged kicking and screaming into the future, and it won't be easy. And I think they are very gently offering us help.
I don't know what it is, but I know it isn't planks and boards. And I may be the only person in the world that can say that, coming from both the science and the fact that I watched one happen. There were no planks and boards. You can throw that idea out. There are people who make them, yes. There are people who go in the fields and amuse themselves. They didn't make the one that I saw happen, and they haven't made these others that we've been testing.
Nancy Talbot is not just one of the most well-known crop circle researchers in the world. She's also one of the few that claims to have seen the phenomenon in action at close hand. In 2001, she visited Robert van der Broeke in Holland, a young man who had also said that he had observed the creation of many crop circles. As she was on her way to bed on the second floor of Robert's house, something suddenly happened.
Seconds, minutes later, this tube of light, this brilliant, about a foot and a half, maybe 2 foot diameter, tube of light came crashing down right in front of those windows, scared the dickens out of me. I mean, it lit up the field outside like daylight, but there wasn't really time to do anything. It only lasted for a second or so. No noise, no smell, no electromagnetic response in the skin, just this brilliant light and enormous force. It stopped, it disappeared. Did that really happen, you know? Before you had time to think about it, another one, same place. Well, whomp, this thing comes down. Exactly the same, the outside lit up like daytime, the inside lights up. And I'm thinking, God, I hope Robert's seeing the same thing, because you don't want to see this sort of thing all by yourself. Before I could get on a bed, by then I'm starting to get on a bed, and had begun, you know, to yell for him. A third tube came crashing down. Well, by this time, he's halfway up the stairs yelling for me, because he's been watching exactly the same thing from downstairs. Now, from my vantage point, the windows, although very high, cut this tube of light off, you know, at a certain point. He was right next to the windows downstairs and could see considerably farther up in the sky. Neither of us saw anything in the sky from which these tubes of light could possibly have come. There was nothing up there. We went to the windows in the bedroom, looked up, saw nothing, went running downstairs to, we're getting ready to go out. And I was a little scared. I'm not brave. I thought, another one of those things comes, I don't want to be underneath it. But Robert, he got brave and he stepped down and nothing happened to him. So I grabbed a flashlight. We went right to the fence, which is about 85, 90 feet behind the house. And there in that field, right on the other side of that fence, and I think I saw steam. I'm not positive. I couldn't really tell because I was just holding a flashlight. But I think I saw steam rising. And there was a brand new crop circle. And it wasn't just a circle. It was an ellipse, as a matter of fact, a very distinct ellipse with a long pathway going off on the northern end and a crossbar, like a capital letter T. And Robert and I just, I mean, it wasn't there earlier. We'd been right there earlier in the evening. And there it was.
Nancy and Robert's experience can only be confirmed by themselves, even though it was clear that there was a pattern in the field of sweet peas the day after. Were they really witnesses to the phenomenon that creates all the genuine crop circles? Or was it just one of many variations of the phenomenon? Are there many different players of both normal and paranormal origin in the fields?
Now, you've got to remember also that there are so-called man-made designs out there. But at the same point in time, I've come across them where I've gone in a few hours after they've arrived and I found additions. And I've looked at it, and then I've spoken to some of them afterwards. They claim that they did it, and I said, okay, well, you did that, fine, let's see the evidence. And they produce all sorts of evidence, and then I'll say, okay, now what about this bit? They say, oh, we didn't do that bit. I said, well, if you didn't do it, who did? I said, we don't know. But it's human arrogance to think that we're the only intelligent life forms in the universe. There are others out there that have abilities way beyond what we're capable of doing. Now, just because we can't see it doesn't mean to say it isn't there.
You sit out here in this field, you know, especially for a night maybe, spend a whole night in this circle, in this geometric pattern, which at this time is a complete mystery. You can sit here and you can ask your own fundamental questions, and there's no need for TV or culture, religion. You know, it's like a personal little church for a night, and you know, it's actually very healthy, and it certainly should be looked at very seriously before being ridiculed. Usually the ridicule is stemming from fear rather than fact.
Personally, I think the message of the crop circles is really important, and I think they are one of the most important things happening on the planet at the moment. I think they speak of Earth changes. I think they speak about changes about human evolution. I think we're being stimulated and pulled forward to consider all kinds of possibilities for the fact that the reality which we perceive at the moment is not in fact the entire reality at all.
It is entirely our free choice to give attention to these things. If they wanted to interfere, they would knock out our computers and our electronics and things like that to really give us a shock. You know, but they're not. They're doing it in the middle of fields, and it is entirely our choice to give these things attention. And even when that's the case, they're not giving any really clear answers. They're saying, form your own conclusions. What are your ideas on this? How do you respond to this? And so they're not interfering. They're more like very enlightened grown-ups working with kids. And you know, and when you're teaching a child, it's best not to say, don't do this and do that. You know, that doesn't really educate a child. It's much better to give a child educational opportunities where they can become aware of the situation and make their own choices. You know, and you've got to set up that experience in a way where the child will figure it out well for themselves, and that is a real education.
Each year you get people saying they're all man-made, they must be a hoax, but equally there's people who refuse to accept that and say, no, this is something which must be investigated more, it's very important. And so what we've found with the crop circles is it has created a whole forum for debate over the nature of reality. There's been nothing like it in modern history, and this whole adventure about arguing between the skeptics and the believers has created this magical space in the middle where we can discuss anything about what the universe is, and all because of these strange patterns appearing in the fields. But we don't actually know where they come from.
One of the finest, most beautiful and original art forms of modern times, still totally mysterious. Is this a process of advanced communication? Or a course of re-education, beginning with the symbols of sacred knowledge and wisdom?
Is the truth to be found up there? Or maybe down there? Or inside us? Or maybe besides us in another dimension? Anyway, it's going to be very interesting to see where this is going to take us.